Hi, everybody. My name is Clifton Ross III, and I'm honored to be a part of this event as we uplift patient voices and empower Black women through education and outreach to participate and effectively engage with researchers and clinicians in cancer-focused cancer research. We are all in this together in order to create a better tomorrow. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die, 'cause I don't know what's out there, far beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know the change gonna come. When I go to the movies and when I go downtown, people always telling me, don't you hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh, yes it will. When I go to my brother, I say, brother, would you help me please? Oh, help me please. But my brother keeps knocking me right back here. Oh, time when I thought I wouldn't last for long, but now I know I've got the strength to carry on. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh, yes it will.
Hello, I'm Chandra Wilson, and I'm so excited to welcome you to Uplifting Patient Voices, Building Trust to Increase Black Women's Participation in Cancer Clinical Trials. This event is brought to you by Project Teach, a collaboration between the Black Women's Health Imperative, Stand Up to Cancer, and Friends of Cancer Research. I'm proud to be a Stand Up to Cancer ambassador and join them in this effort. Oh boy, there are many cancers that disproportionately affect Black women, and Black women are vastly underrepresented in clinical research and trials that may one day lead us to a cure. An analysis of data from the FDA indicates that in trials for 24 of the 31 cancer drugs approved since 2015, fewer than 5% of study patients were Black. Today, we aim to empower Black women through education and outreach to increase their participation in cancer-focused clinical trials. Today, we are honoring Black patient voices in cancer research. It was important for me to participate in this effort today because this is a disease that has personally affected my family. Of my grandmother's 9 siblings, most of them suffered and died from some form of cancer. Many started as breast cancer that metastasized someplace else. So I personally want to know more about clinical trials that affect our community and are safe for us to be involved in, leading to our cures. I look forward to the inspiring and educational stories that will be shared today. So let's get ready for an amazing event featuring a series of dynamic speakers, live musical and spoken word performances, and engaging panel discussions. Enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is such an honor. And ladies and gentlemen, she, he, her, they, all of you. I want to make sure that I'm welcoming and recognizing all of the identities that are showing up here today. We are so happy to have you with us. My name is Dr. Alfie Breland Noble, commonly known as Dr. Alfie. It is my pleasure to moderate this event today. You'll see my eyes go down a little bit because I want to make sure that I am getting all of the names and information correct for you as we do this wonderful event today with Project Teach. I want to thank our beautiful singer who started us off, and Ms. Chandra Wilson for her heartfelt comments to start us off today. And this is a really important topic for many of us, for all of us, and has also touched my family as well, having a mother who passed from pancreatic cancer about 15 years ago. TEACH, I wanna share with you, stands for Trained Empowered Advocates for Community Health and Healing. As a research consultant, grant writer, a scientist of many years, and a disparities researcher, in collaboration with this project in particular, it's my honor to support the goals and initiative that we're going to be speaking to today. Our goal, as you heard Ms. Wilson speak to, is to empower Black women, the sisters specifically, of the diaspora in full, all of us who identify as Black women, so that cancer-focused research meets our needs, our unique needs, being people who face and fight with the dual pandemics, if you will, of racism, sexism, so on and so forth. We need to make sure that we're included in the research because we need the outcomes to reflect our needs. So we have an amazing, incredible lineup of brilliant, articulate, wonderful clinicians, scientists, policymakers, and most importantly, people, women with lived experience to share with you today. So to kick off this event, I'm gonna introduce two incredible women, Mrs. Linda Goler-Blount, President and CEO of the Black Women's Health Imperative. You all know her, you all love her. Brilliant advocate for us all. And the incredible Dr. Lisa Newman, a sister who is the chief of the section of breast surgery at the Weill Cornell Medical Center. I want to welcome both of you to kick us off with a keynote discussion about cancer clinical trials diversity in the midst of the pandemic.
Thank you so much, Dr. Elfie, and thank you for being such a powerful and dedicated partner to the TEACH Project. We could not get this work done without you, and we need you in this, and I have to say it, in this fight every day. So thank you for your brilliance, your dedication, your passion, your spirit. It is so appreciated. Thank you. And I want to extend my thanks and my welcome to all of you. You are in for a treat today because I get to have a conversation with Dr. Lisa Newman. And before I get started, let me just start with just a little bit of sort of table setting. For 39 years, the Black Women's Health Imperative has been the only national organization committed to solving the most pressing physical, financial, and emotional health issues that affect our nation's Black women and girls. And we know, as Chandra said, as Dr. Elfie said, cancer has taken far too many of our mothers, our sisters, our daughters, our loved ones in the Black community. Data from the National Institutes of Health show that African Americans and in fact, the Black diaspora have the highest mortality rate of any racial or ethnic group from cancer overall. And while there's no biologic or genetic determinant for race, we know that cancer and therapeutics to treat cancer affect the Black community differently from others. And we need to know why. We need more Black women in cancer research, both as participants and researchers. And often we talk about evidence-based medicine. Well, what becomes evidence depends on who's asking the questions and who they're asking. And sometimes we end up applying a body of evidence to people who had nothing to do with its creation in the first place. Historical racism, gender discrimination, and the lack of respectful inclusion and engagement of Black women in the research process means that we've been left out of the development of critical therapeutics. If we had adequate clinical trials diversity, we could improve treatments for all diseases, particularly those that disproportionately affect Black women. That's why the Black Women's Health Imperative has partnered with Stand Up to Cancer and Friends of Cancer Research to support the TEACH Project to ensure Black women understand the clinical trials process and what participation looks like, but most importantly, what respectful inclusion looks like, and that researchers understand the importance of including Black women and what respectful inclusion looks like. And all of this is to ensure that research includes Black women so that we get the best possible outcomes and even cures for our mothers, sisters, and daughters. So to talk about how important this is, we are so fortunate to have a brilliant breast surgeon, surgical oncologist, researcher, and women's health advocate for today's keynote conversation, my friend and colleague, Dr. Lisa Newman. Dr. Newman, Lisa, it is so good to have you here today. How are you?
Linda, thank you so much. I'm doing great. It's a blessing to be here with you today. I thank you enough for the honor of participating in such an important initiative, making sure that we have appropriately diverse accrual to cancer clinical trials, essential.
It is, and thank you. You have been on the front lines of research and treatment of cancer in our community for a long time. Can you share a little bit about your research and, you know, hopefully what gives you hope and what concerns you about where we are with breast cancer today?
Thanks, Linda. So yeah, I'm happy to share with you over the next couple of minutes a little information about my own research. But before that, I do that, I do want to also extend some very heartfelt expressions of appreciation to the Black Women's Health Imperative for all the incredible work that you've done. You've been such a powerful force in shining a light on breast cancer disparities. For example, the 40% higher death rates from breast cancer that we see in African-American women compared to white American women. Now, we know that a lot of this disparity is explained by healthcare access barriers leading to delays in a breast cancer diagnosis. Heartbreakingly, there are too many Black women that receive inadequate treatment, and inadequate treatment for a disease that today, if caught early, can be treated with curative intent. Women don't have to suffer to the extent that they do from breast cancer mortality threat. Now, breast cancer is also a great example of why this research is so critical. We do have to address healthcare access barriers and social determinants of health that impact cancer risk, but there are other issues aside from the socioeconomics that impact on the breast cancer disparities that we see. And this is why all women, and especially African-American women, need to be a part of the research. And, you know, it's actually interesting. If you look back in time at breast cancer death rates for Black women compared to white women, those rates used to be equal until we got to the early 1980s. In the early 1980s, we started seeing declining breast cancer death rates in white women, but they were largely unchanging in Black women. And this is because we started unmasking some of the differences in tumor biology between Black women and white women, because at that point, we made some wonderful advances in particular treatments for breast cancer, but they were treatments for estrogen receptor positive breast cancer, which is a specific subset of breast cancer. And it's great that we developed effective treatments for this pattern of breast cancer, but Black women are much less likely to have estrogen receptor positive breast cancer compared to white women. And so we didn't benefit to the same extent that women, that white women did from these advances in treatment. Today, we also know that Black women are twice as likely compared to white women to have a particularly aggressive form of breast cancer known as triple negative breast cancer. And my own research has actually involved international studies where we are looking not only at Black women and white women with breast cancer, but we're also looking at women in different parts of Africa to understand the genetic aspects of African ancestry that contribute to this high risk for triple negative disease. And we have actually identified that some of the genetic roots of having increased risk for triple negative breast cancer is related to our Western sub-Saharan African ancestry. And we see extremely high frequencies of triple negative breast cancer in that part of Africa, Western sub-Saharan Africa, which is where the transatlantic slave trade came from. So we have shared ancestry with women in that part of Africa who also have high rates of triple negative disease. And so we have ongoing research that is very exciting in learning more about these genetic causes of triple negative breast cancer related to African ancestry. And this work will be important for everybody. If we can figure out the causes of triple negative breast cancer and figure out better treatments, this is going to be important for women all around the world because triple negative breast cancer is a biologically more aggressive disease. Mm-hmm. Black women, women of African ancestry, to be a part of this research.
Right. You know, so much people in my field in epidemiology talk about race and health and data, and sometimes we lead people to believe it's because they're Black. But that's not the case with breast cancer. What you're talking about is country of origin and going back generations, that is something we need to look at. So even though I think I know the answer to this question, I'm just going to ask, has there been a large scale study of Black women and triple negative breast cancer?
We unfortunately still do not have adequate representation of women with African ancestry participating on these trials. And so we are getting much too narrow a picture of how triple negative breast cancer afflicts women because we are not addressing the picture comprehensively. We need more women of African ancestry. These are the women that are most likely to be afflicted with this pattern of disease. So if anything, women of African ancestry should be highly overrepresented in the triple negative breast cancer trials. We need to understand the genetics of the disease better. Now, when I talk about the importance of research to understand the genetics of triple negative breast cancer better, I'm not trying to put on the back burner the importance of addressing social determinants of health. The systemic racism that you mentioned earlier, which results in the African-American community having impaired access to screening and impaired access to comprehensive treatments for cancer, these types of barriers do need to be addressed and eliminated, no question. But part of that high quality care that women of all backgrounds need includes clinical trial opportunities. We can only make advances in the treatment by studying novel treatments on clinical trials. We absolutely need to have more African American women on these clinical trials.
Right. And you know, this issue of clinical trials has become sort of front and center in media because of COVID-19. And the development of the vaccines and who was in the trials and who weren't, and the leading manufacturers, you know, Pfizer, BioNTech, and Moderna have said, nope, we've had 10% participation of the Black population in our trials, which is frankly much higher than we see in most other trials. But given that, you know, also COVID-19 has sort of highlighted disparities, I've had many people say, oh, I didn't know health disparities were a thing, you know, until last year, or racism was a thing, or that they were related. My concern is that Black women may be putting off screening mammography or even treatment. Are you seeing anything like that? And what does COVID-19, are there any concerns that you have because of COVID-19 on Black women and breast cancer?
Yeah, you're correct, Linda. First of all, I agree with you that the COVID-19 pandemic and all of its heartbreak happening at the same time that the Black Lives Matter movement became front and center in the media, it did make people more aware, fortunately, of systemic racism and the fact that we had to confront systemic racism head on because we saw it so acutely with the twofold higher COVID mortality rates in the African-American community. And so our academic societies, all of our healthcare institutions. It's great to see that people are thinking about anti-racism efforts and are developing diversity, equity, inclusion committees all over. That's great that they're putting a lot of thought into addressing the issue. But there are some problems that have also become magnified with COVID. The economic recession related to COVID was definitely disproportionately worse on the African-American community. And these higher rates of joblessness in Blacks compared to whites because of COVID means that more people lost job-related insurance, which affects the individual and their families. And so African-Americans, unfortunately, we're seeing more delays in getting back into screening practices. We are starting to see the impact of this on breast cancer. We've looked at this in our own metropolitan New York community, and we are already starting to see widening of the disparities in terms of Black women presenting with larger tumors. I think it's going to get worse because, unfortunately, our African-American community is going to be slower to get back into screening because of these economic hardships. Yeah. Now, there are some bright lights. This whole experience has kind of brought a whole nother element to partnerships between community outreach organizations, cancer treating physicians, and the cancer advocacy community. For example, I've had the pleasure of working with African American breast cancer support organizations to conduct educational programs in the community regarding the importance of getting vaccinated, especially in the African-American community. So we've all taken our responsibilities to another level in the confronting not only cancer disparities, but the COVID disparities.
So, you know, to your point, hopefully for many physicians and those in public health, this will cause them, this experience with COVID-19 will cause them to sort of expand their perspective and even their work. You know, as I think about clinical trials and research. You know, as we know, too few Black people are included in clinical research as participants, but as researchers as well. And so one of the key themes from the TEACH project is that, you know, we wanted to hear from Black patients to describe their experiences. And unfortunately, many have talked about how uncomfortable or just outright disrespected or disregarded they have felt when trying to participate in clinical trials. We also know the number one reason Black people don't participate in clinical trials is because nobody asks them. So I'm curious from your experience, I mean, there's your experience as a researcher, but you're also talking to your researcher colleagues. What are you hearing from patients? And what are you hearing from your colleagues about sort of their views on the importance of diversity, or as I often hear, the challenges of reaching the Black and brown population for clinical trials participation?
Yeah. Well, I am very glad that you underscored the issue of workforce diversity. That is a major problem, and this is a major pipeline problem. We need to improve, to strengthen the public school system so that more kids growing up are thinking about careers in sciences and healthcare. That is a huge issue. We definitely, I personally believe, will improve the quality of the care that we deliver if we have a more diverse workforce in terms of persons of color in medicine and in the sciences. It will improve our ability to deliver healthcare, not only because we then connect with our patient population better, but you bring in more diversity of thought and more talent to the table when it comes to generating advances in cancer treatment. Disparities questions related to how cancer affects different populations differently. These types of research questions need to be part of the design of our clinical trials to make these trials more meaningful. You also raised an extremely relevant point in terms of African-American patients not being presented with equal opportunities to present in clinical trials. The reality is that the high majority of the professional clinical trials community today is white American and very heavily white American males. And the data are absolutely out there that they are less likely to spend the time explaining and offering clinical trials to African American cancer patients. some of that is part of this systemic racism problem. It just is, heartbreakingly. Some of it is more subconscious, where the physician may fear that he or she is going to alienate the patient because of overblown fears that African-American patients are going to automatically mistrust them, or that it'll compromise the relationship if they bring up clinical trials opportunity. They have to get over that. It's a quality of care metric that all patients be offered all treatment opportunities, especially clinical trial participation opportunities. So I think that if we strengthen the workforce, if we educate our colleagues, which I'm so glad that you are doing with this wonderful initiative in TEACH, I think we will go a long way in improving things. We also need to advocate on behalf of legislation to make it easier for patients to participate in clinical trials. There's financial toxicity that goes along with extra clinic visits related to clinical trial participation, losing days at work, transportation. We need to support these financial hurdles.
Yeah, I'm so glad you mentioned that, because while clinical trials participation is free in that patients don't have to pay for it, it's not free because you have to get there. It may require time off from work, and these all have costs. So we just have a minute left. I knew this conversation was going to go by way fast. And you mentioned something that I'd like you to sort of end on. We're about trying to empower patients with the TEACH program, but sometimes patients are afraid to challenge their providers. So what would you say to patients who want to participate, want to advocate, but perhaps don't feel comfortable doing that? We're going to give them a toolkit to do it. So we're going to give them some resources. But you're a physician. If you want your patients to advocate, what does that look like to you? What do Black women need to know about breast cancer research and advocating for themselves?
Yeah. So it, first of all, is worth it. And it is very unfortunate that we put this additional burden on the plate of a cancer patient, because they're already dealing with a very vulnerable time in their lives. But clinical trial participation is worth it, because it not only gives us an opportunity to advance treatments, and in particular, we need to advance those treatments in communities of color and understanding how various treatments work in communities of color. And clinical trial participation is a safeguard against discriminatory practices in healthcare delivery. Clinical trials participation is very tightly regulated, so the treatment delivered is monitored, the outcomes are monitored, and the follow-up is monitored. So it really is a safeguard to make sure that patients are getting highest quality care. So it is absolutely worth it.
All right. Well, Dr. Lisa Newman, my friend, thank you so much for your work, for your advocacy, for your research, for helping us today and understand the importance of clinical trials and participating. Thank you so much. Be well and be safe.
Thank you for what you're doing, Linda. It's wonderful.
Thank you. And now we will hear from one of our TEACH committee members, Dr. Marion Johnson Thompson.
Hello, my name is Marion Johnson Thompson. I am a retired academic and a health scientist administrator from the National Institutes of Health. I am a co-survivor, cancer advocate, and a member of the Project TEACH Advisory Committee. I became involved in advocating for Black women and their health because my aunt and uncle both passed from cancer. And it was then that I began to realize all of the cancer disparities that impacted Black women. And I began to join advocacy groups, which allowed me to learn more about the issues, as well as how I could advocate more successfully for Black women. I believe it's so important for Black women to be involved in clinical trials and become empowered in doing this, because there are a number of cancers that impact Black women to a greater extent. It may seem scary. Actually, I've participated in several, and I'm in three now, and initially it was scary. But most important, I knew that I was contributing to helping others who may be suffering from cancer. We really need to have more clinical trials that involve Black women.
I want to thank our speakers from our first panel. I learned quite a bit listening, even though I've been in the clinical trials field for over 20 years at this point. It was really enlightening for me to hear what some of the experiences are from the researcher clinician side in terms of how we engage Black women. It was wonderful to see two Black women having this conversation as leaders in the field. And so we're going to pivot just a little bit to a panel discussion. And one of the things I want to say before we dive into this discussion is that it is critical, going back to what Dr. Newman said and what Ms. Blount said, Golder Blount said in their keynote conversation, that Black women, Black people be included in clinical trials. And what I will add from a behavioral researcher perspective is that part of that inclusion really is about what do we as researchers, what do researchers and clinicians do to ensure that patients feel welcome, included, and engaged and empowered to participate effectively in the development of treatments that are going to be for their benefit and the benefit of people in their communities. And so as a part of this, we within the Project Teach program are working to prioritize the needs of people with lived experience. That is the storehouse of knowledge. People who have been through this experience either themselves or, as Dr. Johnson Thompson shared, with loved ones. And so we have to make sure that we prioritize those needs along with prioritizing the needs of researchers. It needs to be a mutually beneficial experience for everyone. And so with that, one of the things that we want to do is to queue up a video to share with you. And I'm reading just a bit. Our video speaks to Project Teach's suite of tools. You've heard who all the partners are. And so we're going to watch this video briefly, and we're going to come back, and I'll introduce our panel, and we'll dive into the panel discussion.
Women are vastly underrepresented in cancer research. To address this disparity, the Black Women's Health Imperative partnered with Stand Up to Cancer and Friends of Cancer Research to develop Project Teach. Project Teach stands for Trained Empowered Advocates for Community Health. This innovative initiative will provide tools to empower Black women through education and outreach to participate and engage with researchers and clinicians to increase participation of Black women in cancer-focused clinical trials. The Project Teach online education course is a new tool for Black women across the country to learn more about their health and how to empower themselves and future generations. Learners can pace themselves through the self-guided course, interacting with a variety of content, visuals, and videos. You'll start to understand how the past has impacted your health and what role clinical trials play in understanding your treatments. You'll learn from examples of effective advocacy and how you can be a successful participant in research. After taking the course, you'll be a Certified Engaged Patient Partner, or EPP, through Project Teach. Prepare to actively engage with your peers, researchers, and clinicians to help increase awareness and participation of Black women in clinical trials. So take the time, get involved, get educated, and impact change through Project Teach.
So I love that video. The absolute best part of that video was that cute baby with her Afro puffs. She makes me want to go change my hairstyle real quick. She was adorable. And again, in addition to going through that course and becoming an engaged patient partner, the other thing that our hope is that you will be an empowered patient partner, because there's nothing better. I know this from personal experience and having people at the table with me who are what I call community scientists. These are people with lived experience. These are people who have been through the very things that we're trying to study. And these are the people with the absolute best knowledge to teach us, those of us who identify ourselves as traditional academic researchers, the best ways to create improvements in care, better engagement for Black women. And to Dr. Newman's point, better outcomes across all kinds of outcomes and across all levels. So with that, we're going to dive into this discussion. It is my pleasure to introduce this stellar panel of experts. We will start with, and I ask you to help me welcome, Dr. Fola May. She is an assistant professor of medicine at the University of California, Los Angeles, UCLA. It is my pleasure to welcome her. Thank you, Dr. May, for joining us. Dr. Charlotte, Women's Health, U.S. Medical Affairs for AbbVie Incorporated. Welcome, Dr. Owens. Dr. Lori J. Pierce, the president of the American Society of Clinical Oncology, or ASCO. Welcome, Dr. Pierce. It is wonderful to have you. And Ms. Nina Pryor, one of the most important people. All these sisters are important, but if we don't have people like Ms. Pryor to join us, we don't have the opportunity to do the work that we do. So we can't do what we do if we don't have a Ms. Pryor at the table, right at the table with us, giving us direction. And Ms. Pryor is a focus group participant with us through Project Teach and a cancer survivor. So we are so blessed to have you here, sister, and just thank you all for joining us. So what I would love to do is to start with, I'm gonna go off script just a little teeny bit. I would love to hear from each of you 30 seconds of your thoughts on why this work is important to you. What brings you to this work? And we'll start with Dr. May. Would you bless us with an answer to that?
Well, first of all, I want to say a good day to everybody, and thank you very much for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here. And this has been such an incredible conversation so far, and I'm looking forward to hearing more. I'm a health equity researcher. I work at UCLA Health, where I'm also a quality director for our health system. And one of the things that inspired me to participate in this conversation today is just the paucity or the low numbers of African-Americans that I see in clinical trials. I read the papers, I see the data that come out in the journals, in the peer-reviewed articles. I also see the patients that are coming through the health center to enroll in clinical trials and to participate in the visits, and they very rarely are African-American. We need to do better. We need to inform patients the benefits of participating in this work. And we need to, you know, that will allow us to take better care of our community. So that's why I'm just so excited about this conversation today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. May. Dr. Owens, do you want to take a try at that question?
Sure. Again, thanks again for allowing me to participate in today's panel with such esteemed colleagues. I think the key is the whole purpose of clinical research is to help inform us how to be our best selves, how to be our healthiest. And if we do not have diversity of participation that includes African-American women in the research, we really do not understand how to best care for them. We do not understand how to best care for anyone, because there are some distinct differences that are uncovered when you're more inclusive and when you're able to have information. So the way I like to think about it is that we're all healthier when we all participate.
Thank you so much, Dr. Owens. Wonderfully said. Dr. Pierce, would you share with us a little bit about your investment and what brings you to this work?
Yes, first of all, I am delighted to be here. And as the president of ASCO, I am acutely aware of the cancer statistics. And clearly, as you heard from Dr. Newman, African-Americans do worse. In just about any metric, and just about any cancer, you see worse outcomes. So what is a key ticket to doing better? Participation in clinical trials. You've already heard that clinical trials, participating and having a diverse group of patients in clinical trials, allow us to know that our new therapies can then be safely disseminated to a diverse population. But also to the person who's actually going on the clinical trial, you're guaranteed to get the very best treatment. So it is an important point for the person who's being treated, and also important for those who will be rewarded by your participation in the clinical trial.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pierce. And Ms. Pryor, last but not least, what brings you to this work and makes you want to get involved in the way that you've been involved, volunteering with Project Teach to be a part of our research and your advocacy work? What brings you to this? What makes you want to do this work?
So first off, good afternoon, everyone. I am really delighted to be here this afternoon. But what brings me to this work is being an educator. It is important for me to know how important it is for Black women to be educated with clinical trials, just breast cancer, period. And just knowing the resources that are available and just being able to be empowered and know exactly what it is and how we can actually beat this disease.
Thank you so much, Ms. Pryor. I really appreciate your comments. So now I'm gonna go back on script so everybody knows the questions that are coming next. And I appreciate you indulging me because I just really feel like one of the most important things we can do is humanize ourselves for all the people who are watching us. Because I think sometimes what sort of puts people off a little bit, I'll speak to my experience, is people come in the clinic. I remember going in the clinic with my mother when she was first diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, and the discussions around clinical trials participation were interesting, to say the least. And so just watching my family respond to the clinician, the physician, the nurses, and in one case, the social worker, when they were talking to us about, well, you know, we have this opportunity, and I'm sort of thinking, because the approach was wrong. And I think what we're going to be able to learn today is how can we get it right? You all are going to educate us about what we can do better to ensure that as an advocate of a person who might be diagnosed with cancer, as a person who might have cancer ourselves, that you're going to educate us about what do we need to do to be the best empowered, most well-informed, ask the right questions, and then what to look for, right? How do people need to be approaching us when they want us to participate in clinical trials? So my first question is, then I'll pitch it to someone because we're in a virtual space. Black women have often expressed much higher medical mistrust. That's not a surprise to anybody here. And feeling that their thoughts, their symptoms, their problems, their concerns are overlooked and ignored, even when they voice them, right? So it's not a matter of they're invisible. It's that sometimes Black women will voice their concerns and people gloss over them as if they haven't said anything. And so what I wanna ask first is, how can physicians, and I would add scientists, address the medical mistrust that many Black cancer patients experience? And how about we start with you, Dr. Pierce? What would you say to that?
So first of all, I always tell my patients, you have to be comfortable with the caregivers that you have, because you're the captain of the ship. And so make sure that you are comfortable. And if not, you may need to make a change. So for those patients who don't feel like they can speak up, please speak up, because communication is so important. I'll tell you a story. I'm the head of a collaboration in the state of Michigan for the radiation oncology practices. And one of the key things that we do in this collaboration is we obtain patient-reported outcomes. So patients come in for their radiation, they fill out a form saying they're pleased with their treatment, they weren't pleased, you know, the side effects, those kinds of things. And it empowers patients to be able to provide feedback. Well, we also get feedback from the physicians as they interact with their patients. And recently we analyzed among our breast cancer patients those two responses from the patients and from the physicians. And interestingly, we found out that for breast cancer patients, particularly African-American women, that they would often say they were having pain associated with their treatment, and the physician said patient reported no pain. And so we presented this at a large breast cancer meeting, a national meeting, but more importantly, we presented this within the collaboration, and physicians were shocked, because we were able to show which institutions had that disconnect. And it was a very acute awareness. It was an aha moment for physicians. And it was made possible because patients came forward and presented their feelings. So always feel that you are empowered to say something. And we're actually going to follow up now that we had that aha moment to make sure that we see more of a concordance with reporting. But it just shows you how important physician feedback is from patients for physicians to hear. I'll also say that, and something that Dr. Newman brought up, many African-American patients will feel better and more comfortable with a provider of color. At ASCO, we're doing a lot to increase the numbers of cancer providers of color. We can talk about that later if you want. But I also want to say that while we certainly want more providers of color, you shouldn't have to find a provider of color to get that level of comfort. More institutions are providing unconscious bias training and cultural humility training. And lately, with all of the highly visible acts of racism and hatred, there is now a discussion among physicians. And it's unlike any discussion that I've been aware of before. So I think people are becoming acutely aware that patients matter, Black patients matter, Black female patients matter, and your voice is very important.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pierce. I want to bring you in, Ms. Pryor, and tell us a little bit about your thoughts. What do you hear? What have your own experiences been that you feel comfortable sharing with us about this idea of why Black women might be mistrustful of clinical trials, clinical research, and or the providers?
Sure. I can go back all the way to when I was, before I was diagnosed, I went into the doctor's office and I say, hey, I'm feeling a lump. And I was told, well, hey, because of your age, you might just hold off a little bit. It may be fibrous. So for me, I was like, oh, it may be fibrous. I'm going to go on about my life, you know. And so months went by before I went back to the doctor. And I didn't even go back because of the lump. It was like a byproduct. Like, hey, I came back and I'm still feeling this lump. And again, that was 10 months later. So then after being not diagnosed, I was diagnosed with stage 3 ductal carcinoma. And so when I went and had my mastectomy and immediate reconstruction, as I was in recovery, I was telling the doctor, I was like, I am feeling horrible. Like my pain level was on 10 every time they came. And so he told me, it was a white man. He said, oh, just go home. They're not going to give you anything stronger. So just go home and recover. Mm-hmm. So every day we kept getting up, taking the medicine that was prescribed. And when it got to, and this was a Friday, I woke up and I told my husband, I cannot do this anymore. Like, you're going to have to do something. Somebody, I need to go to the emergency room, something. I cannot take this anymore. So I go back to the, and this was the plastic surgeon at the time. I go back there and he says, well, you know, your exam, you know, I don't see anything. So, you know what, just go home and take some Tylenol. So that Sunday rolls around and my chest just starts to leak. And so when I went to, I called them back. They said, oh, come back in on Monday. So I went back in on Monday and clearly it was infected. And when I got in, his nurse was like, hold on 1 second. And then when the doctor came in, he looked at me, he sat down. And he says, well, because I had a latissimus flap at that time for reconstruction. And he was like, I've never seen anything like this. Mm-hmm. So what I need you to do, I just need you to go across the street. We're going to have, you know, immediate emergency surgery, you know, to take the tissue expanders that they had put in. You know, so from the beginning, you know, and I've had several times where I've gone to doctors and I told them like, hey, I'm having this issue. I'm in pain. And they're like, oh, that's okay. Just go home and just see what happens. And so I think that becomes where the level of mistrust comes from, is because we're voicing how we feel and we're just being ignored.
Oh, Ms. Pryor, I'm so sorry to hear that that was your experience. And I really appreciate you being so forthcoming and sharing with us. I want to bring you in, Dr. May. What would you say, what would you say to a patient who's had an experience similar to Ms. Pryor's? How do we help encourage and help heal some of those experiences so that people can feel comfortable coming back into care, coming back, you know, and being trustful? Because not every physician is like that, right? But we also don't want to minimize people's real experiences. And so if you have an experience like that, I can see where it would make somebody quite apprehensive the next time they want to go in. Because what she described was being very vocal, being very clear. And in her instance, Ms. Pryor's instance, not being heard or treated with, you know, or her issues being treated with respect. So of course you're not here to fix that, but I wonder what thoughts do you have, Dr. May, about how do we support Black women when they have these kinds of experiences? And then later we say, oh, do you want to be in this clinical trial? You know, I'm assuming they're gonna be like, no. So how do we help people manage that? What can we do?
And I'm so thrilled that Ms. Pryor shared that story, because I think it's a perfect demonstration of the problems that our patients are seeing in healthcare systems. And Dr. Pierce alluded to this as well. You asked us, what can providers do to help overcome the mistrust that patients have? And I often like to flip that around. We need to do a much better job with our providers, because providers do not understand that their mistrust is rightful. We have, as we just saw with the data from Dr. Pierce's study, our research project, white physicians are just not as attuned sometimes to the reports that Black patients are providing. And these are not just subjective, there is objective data. There are studies that show that when delivering bad news to a Black patient, providers are more likely to stand at the door rather than pull up a chair and sit next to a patient. So there are definitely differences in how providers are providing care for patients. And that's why I call it a rightful mistrust. We like to talk about historical events, you know, the violations of Black and brown bodies for the last 400 years in this country. And of course, that's a factor. But this mistrust is also a result of the very things that patients are experiencing today when they walk into a health system. So what can our patients do? They have to remain vocal. They have to find advocates. As Dr. Pierce said, they have to find providers that they trust. They have to go to those providers repeatedly. And sometimes they need to seek out new providers when necessary. I know some of my patients, they might be having a gynecologic issue, but if there's something that's an urgent problem that doctor's not paying attention to, they have to reach out to their surgeon or their primary care doctor because they know that individual will help them escalate the problem. And sometimes, as we learned just now from Ms. Pryor, it is showing up at the health center and demonstrating what the problem is and being very vocal that you need care. I think it's very unfortunate that that's the reality of our health system today. But like I was saying earlier, the main focus needs to be on better training our physicians so that we don't require this moving forward.
Thank you so much, Dr. May. That's so well said. I love this idea of, and that's part of the TEACH program, that there's mutually beneficial ways to help improve things, right? So it's not all on patients. Some of it is on those of us who are on the other side, you know, and let's be honest. In some form or fashion, at some point in our lives, every one of us might be a patient, right? Every one of us has that experience. And so I think bringing that into the work that we do can really help support and build out our responses, to your point, Dr. May, as providers, as the people who are providing care. So one thing I want to pitch to the group, I think we lost Dr. Owens. When we get her back, I want to pitch a question to her specifically. But some of what we learned through the work that we've done in TEACH has to do with this persistent. Oh, we have Dr. Owens back. So let me go to you, Dr. Owens, because I had a question that I wanted to ask you specifically. And one of the things I'm really curious about and want to understand better is this idea of building off of what Dr. May said. There's this concept that if people, and I think Dr. Pierce alluded to it as well, that if the provider looks like you, that increases the, I don't know, acceptance by patients, or that increases the likelihood that it builds the rapport, it makes it better. I'm wondering from your perspective and in your work, in your leadership role within the organization, looking around and knowing that there are not a lot of providers out there who look like us, who are going to be able to be in front of patients at any given time. Can you speak to any of the thoughts that you have about how do we build leadership in a way that allows non-Black providers, providers who are not of color, as scientists, researchers, policymakers, so on and so forth, and clinicians, how do we support them in learning some of what's needed to reduce these health disparities and reduce these gaps in terms of clinical trials and Black women's participation?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think Dr. Pierce said it well. We should not have to find someone who looks like us in order to really be heard. So there's a difference in listening and being heard. And I think when we're looking to have clinical trial participation, there's three different areas that every physician researcher should really consider. Number one, are you able to really understand what your patient is saying? And this goes both ways. It's not just the patient having a voice, which is really important. I also believe that patients should have advocates, someone independent of themselves, so that they can focus on being a patient and have someone to advocate for them. But the clinician themselves should repeat what they heard to the patient to make sure that they're understanding what their patient is going through. You know, I use that technique myself when I see patients. I really try to make sure that I am articulating what I heard them say. And when you do that, you can develop trust and you can develop rapport. And that's important because without that, nothing goes well. You should not only feel good about the way you've presented yourself in the office, you should also feel good about the rapport that you've established with the physician and their ability to hear you, not just listen. I mean, not just to take you at the first glance. They really have to listen and understand what you're saying and be able to articulate that. There also has to be a level of comfort. So if you realize that you're not of the same race, of the same gender even as your patient, what can you do to make sure that you are exhibiting the ability to empathize and at least understand their perspective? Because until you can really understand the perspective of the patient and believe what they're saying and then trust that what they're saying to you is exactly what they mean, then you're not really able to meet the needs of the patient. So I do think it's a two-way street.
I love that. I love all that you speak to my heart as a behavioral person, because the restating, summarizing, that's all those clinical skills that we're taught, right? That not everybody uses. So I think it's really important because, to your point, Dr. Owens, I think one thing that's universal, particularly when you are a person of color or come from a marginalized population, I feel like we all want a couple of things. One is to be seen, one is to feel heard, and the third is to feel valued. And the third is contingent upon the first two. So if you don't see me and you don't hear me, I don't ever feel valued. And so what you all are speaking to is what needs to happen in the clinical encounter around this issue of clinical trials to allow patients to feel seen, heard, and valued. And so I want to pivot a tiny bit and speak a little bit to something that I know would be really important to Ms. Goler-Blount in her role as an epidemiologist. And one of the things I wonder about is the role of insurance coverage, right? So one of the questions that we've asked through TEACH is there a persistent problem of inadequate insurance coverage? Going back to what our speaker said, Ms. Dr. Newman said in the opening keynote, is there an issue with insurance coverage, and is there a relationship between low or lack of insurance coverage as a that serving as a barrier to cancer treatment for Black patients? So I mean, it's kind of a self-explanatory question, but would anybody like to tackle that? Or not just self-explanatory, but probably very obvious what the answer to that is. But would any of you like to tackle that and speak a little bit to that issue of insurance coverage and cancer treatment for Black women?
So I'll start. Certainly we know that patients who have insurance do better if they're diagnosed with cancer, because they then can get the treatments that they deserve. And certainly Medicaid, Medicare, and the Affordable Care Act are critical sources of insurance coverage for Black Americans. And with regard to the ACA, I was recently on a panel about the ACA. It's now had 10 years of the ACA. And while no law is perfect, the ACA is so important because obviously millions of people, 20 million people who were previously uninsured became insured because of the ACA. And one thing that was a problem for the ACA was when the Supreme Court said that the states could decide whether or not to expand Medicaid coverage. And we have 12 states that still have not expanded Medicaid coverage, and they are disproportionately in the southeastern portion of the country, which is where more Black people live. Mm-hmm. So there's less of an opportunity for people of color, particularly in the southeast, to have access to expansion of Medicaid. And I know there's a lot of work being done in the government now trying to find ways to encourage those 12 states to expand Medicaid. But that's one disconnect for Black patients. On a positive note, though, and I do want to have a positive note, is that Congress recently enacted key legislation to enable Medicaid patients to have their routine care costs covered if they go on clinical trials. I just want to spend a moment about that. Mm-hmm. Medicare patients and patients covered by private insurance previously had the routine costs that come up with being on a clinical trials covered by their insurance. And that's when you see your doctor, when you get blood tests, when you get x-rays, those were all covered by the insurance. Medicaid was the only major insurer that did not cover routine care costs. And ASCO and other societies advocated very strongly for this for quite a while, and now it has been made law. So as of January of 2022, if you are a Medicaid patient, there is not a disincentive to go on clinical trials. So it kind of comes full circle with what we're talking about today. You don't want to have anything that's a disincentive for people to go on clinical trials. And certainly for those who are very underrepresented, as are Black people and Black women. So I'm happy to say that because of a lot of advocacy work on by many organizations, particularly ASCO, that has been corrected as of January of next year.
That is incredibly helpful. And it's wonderful context because there are nuances of what you shared that I was not aware of. It didn't occur to me that there might be costs associated with participating mm-hmm. in the clinical, right? Like that's not something that I think most of us think about. So I really appreciate the context. And I appreciate the response to the question. So I want to make sure we get, because I want to pull from this wisdom base, like I'm thinking of the motherboard at church. I have this wisdom base over here and I want to make sure that I tackle all of it and bring all of you in. So Dr. Pierce, I appreciate the answer to the question. One question I have, and I think Ms. Pryor and Dr. May, you may be able to speak to this both. All of you can, but I would like to start with you two, is this idea of how do we increase awareness about cancer research and clinical trials among Black patients? And let me just give a little bit of context. I think that often, going back to something Dr. May said, when we hear clinical research, what a lot of us immediately think, not all of us, right? Because we're not all identified as African-American. Some folks who identify as African immigrant or Caribbean immigrant or even Black Latinx populations may not necessarily have this historical context as part of their the folklore in their families of Tuskegee, right? If you recently immigrated, Tuskegee might not be a thing for you.
Yeah.
So what I'm wondering about is, for many of us, that's where our minds go. But people have other reasons why they don't want to participate in clinical trials. And so I'm wondering if you can speak to this question of, if doctors are not mentioning trials to Black patients, what mechanisms can we use to increase their awareness? How do we help people know that this is something they can do? So Dr. May, would you start? And then Ms. Pryor, if you would add to that as well.
Sure, I'm happy to start. And I think this is exactly demonstrates the need for projects like Project Teach. We need to do a better job of getting the information out there that these trials are available, that they're safe, that they often provide even better treatment options, because I think sometimes there's a misconception that you're going to be a guinea pig and they're going to try a medication on you that is not going to be effective, which is often not the case in a lot of these trials. So I think Project Teach is extraordinary and I was excited to hear about it. And we need to find ways to get this information to more patients. So I like to think about opportunities where cancer centers, for example, because we've got accredited cancer centers all across the country, all across the nation, and other places where there is high volume of cancer care, use materials like the ones that are available at Project Teach, that they can disseminate that into communities of color. I also like the opportunity of increasing funding for organizations like Project Teach, having other individuals come into this space to disseminate this information. And I also think that we need to trickle down this information from the ivory towers, that is the academic health centers, to places like federally qualified health centers. Most of the patients that I work with in federally qualified health centers are Black and Brown. They don't come to the west side of LA to UCLA for care right away unless they need a super specialist. So if we're not disseminating the information about the availability of trials where Black patients and Black women are being seen, there's no way they're going to know about the potential benefits of participating. So we've got a long way of going to make sure that the information's in the right place so that the right people have access to it.
Wonderfully said, Dr. May. Wonderfully said. So Ms. Pryor, do you want to add to that? How do we increase information and knowledge about clinical trials for Black folks?
Sure. I agree with Dr. May. The first thing comes from the education of it all. What spaces are created to where we can actually educate women on these things? And even from the standpoint of not waiting until it happens to us, what are those things that can be done to get it on the front end? You know, even from talking to young women, you know, even with programs that start like in middle school, talking about breast health and things of that nature. But when it comes to clinical trials, like I said, first of all, like I said, if it's not being presented, people are not going to know. But then the other factors of those are just making sure that sometimes it's not what you say, it's how you say it. Because if you go in and people are saying, hey, you should do this, and you feel good about it yourself, and then there is also some data that can be provided. Because for me, like, I need to know, you need to let me know what's happening so I can make an informed decision. And so again, it's the way that it is presented as well can be a key factor in why, you know, some people don't want to do clinical trials.
I love that. Now, you channeling, as I've shared at the opening, that my mom, God rest her soul, is transitioned. But that's exactly what mama used to say. It's not always what you say, it's how you say it, right? How are you presenting this to me? And I think that's really critical for any marginalized population, because people already have apprehensions. So we have to sort of cut through the apprehension, justified apprehension, to Dr. May's point earlier, to make sure that people know that we see value and hear them, and that there's a reason we want them to engage in trials, and that we want to make it clear and easy for people to understand. So Dr. Owens, I want to come to you. And one of the things I want to ask you is a question that's come from the audience. I think it's a great question. I definitely don't know the answer, and I'm hoping you can give us some insight. So the question is, and I'm going to add a little twist to it. Do we know how many Black physician-led clinical trials are being conducted in the space of clinical trials research for cancer? And is there any organization that captures this data, that's capturing this data? And then the final question, this is my little twist. How can we find out who's leading clinical trials? How do we know if we're being asked to participate in a clinical trial? My assumption is it's not necessarily the person who's asking us who's the principal investigator, right? They might be a site investigator, or they might be a co-investigator, but how do we learn more? So this question of how do we, I think in summary, how do we learn where to find Black people who might be leading some of these clinical trials?
That's a great question. So in general, let's talk about where can you find information about clinical trials. Well, interventional trials are listed on a website known as clinicaltrials.gov. And it's publicly available. Everyone can go to that website. You can search by various different terms. You can search by the disease. You can search by an institution. You can search in a wide variety of ways to find out information about clinical trials. Now, as you scroll down through that list, you'll not only find out the name of the trial, you'll find out the purpose, you'll find out the stage of the trial. You'll also, the phase of the trial. You'll also find every single clinical trial site with the investigator name. And this allows you to do a geographical search. And most of the times, once you find the institution and you find the name of the investigator there, you can look to see, is the person male or female? You will also obviously sometimes be able to see pictures, et cetera. To my knowledge, there are a few various different websites of places that are really trying to track the improvement of minority investigators and minority participants that will have a list of members. But I will say that every single interventional clinical trial will be listed on clinicaltrials.gov, especially if it is going through various different phases of either trying to get approval from the FDA, or if it is already approved and we're seeking to find more information. And that's something that's important, because as long as you have the ability to search, you have the ability to get knowledge. And that is really key.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dr. Owens. I've like just listening to you all, I'm learning so much about this process. And I have a master's in clinical trials, so I thought I knew clinical trials. But I'm just learning so much from what you all are sharing. So I really do appreciate that. So as we wind down, I want to pitch one question to you, Ms. Pryor, and then any of the panelists who also want to weigh in on this question, I would love for you to. This is another question from the audience, and then we have about a minute. So I'm going to do the fast round robin thing like they do on the news. So Ms. Pryor, can you tell us one or two questions? The question from the audience is, what, and I'm going to ask us to limit it to one or two, what are key questions that we should be asking after we receive a diagnosis? So Ms. Pryor, you start, and if my fellow panelists, if you would like to weigh in on that, please do.
Well, I would say first, if someone is newly diagnosed, I think it's important, if they can, to have some other people with them. Because when you are initially diagnosed, it's like, you know, like they say Charlie Brown, you know, the adults on there, you can't really focus on getting better because you're still in shock. So some things I feel like you should ask your physician is, what types of treatments do you feel are best for me? And also, though, I think it's important for people to know what exactly have I been diagnosed with? Because sometimes people can say, oh, you just have, you know, have this. And for most people, if you've never been around cancer, you have no clue what it is that they're talking about. So really just being able to have just that breakdown in exactly what is it that I'm being diagnosed with and what are some great treatment options that are available for me.
Thank you so much, Ms. Pryor. I had to get myself off mute. I'm so sorry. So we're closing. So I want to see if right before we close, any of my fellow panelists, first, let me make sure I thank all of you, Dr. Pierce, Dr. May, Dr. Owens, and Ms. Pryor. I really do want to thank you. And as we close, I wonder if any of my other panelists has one final thing they'd like to say that we haven't had a chance for you to say. So maybe we're not going to have you answer the question, but are there any parting words you would like to give to the audience? Please do.
Remember that you're not alone and seek the attention and the guidance from people that you trust, and no question that you have in your mind should go unasked.
Absolutely. And first of all, I just want to say thank you for having me. And I'm just going to build on what Dr. Owen said. If you don't feel comfortable, seek other care. That's my number one piece of advice.
I just want to add that Ms. Pryor's comments were just spot on. Have many people there with you that you can process the information and reach your level of comfort with your provider, because trust is so important in that relationship.
This was fabulous. The Black girl magic all over the place. I am just like elated. Like, I know it's a serious and heavy topic, but you all have just brought so much wisdom and light to this and encouragement, and help empower all of us. So I do want to thank every single one of you for being with us and giving us some of your time. So everybody out there in the universe, y'all be clapping where you are, because I'm clapping here too for this wonderful panel that we've just had today. So thank you again. Now thank we're going you. To move to a Pulitzer Prize winning poet, Tracy K. Smith, who will deliver a poetry performance for us. Thank you so much.
Oh. I'm Tracy K. Smith, and I'm grateful to join you today. My mother was diagnosed with colon cancer in 1990, in the weeks before I left home for college. She underwent treatment. The cancer went into remission. She and my father exhaled into a state of gratitude and relief that one summer and autumn led them to take a drive across North America together. And then in the final months of my senior year of college, when my mother was only 59 years old, just a decade older than I am now, her cancer came out of remission. I spent the last months of my mother's life at home in California with her. My whole family was fortunate enough to be able to gather around her during this time and to be for one another in the difficult period that followed. From my perspective now, as an adult and as a Black woman who has experienced the range of attitudes and demeanors my race elicits from people in positions of authority, I wonder if my mother's standard of care and the counseling she received did enough to address her options and to listen to her needs and apprehensions. I wonder if she was judged to be worthy of the care that might have saved her. This isn't the first thing I think of when I think of my mother or her death, but it is a question I live with. And so I am pleased to be part of this powerful event hosted by the Teach Project, which is committed to prioritizing Black women in cancer research. As Black women, we can play an important role in the ways that cancer is treated, researched, talked about, and most importantly, survived. My mother didn't overcome her cancer, but she survives for me as a guiding presence, a source of comfort, and a model for living with love, generosity, and courage. I'd like to share an excerpt with you of my memoir, Ordinary Light, which explores my life with my mother and the experience of losing her. In the weeks following the funeral, after all the distant family had left and routine began to reassert itself, I found it surprising that there was space for so many of my ordinary moods, stretches of any given day when everything or almost everything felt normal or almost normal. But then I'd catch myself thinking of my mother as if she were there, just a room away, and the reality of her death crept back in like the mortar between bricks, holding everything in place in a strange after that no longer included her. Back when I was in grade school and fascinated by anything old-fashioned, I'd convinced my mother to buy me a few kerosene lamps. I liked to read by them, even though their light was flickering. It made me feel like I could step inside history and live there a while. Not my same self, but not quite a stranger either. My mother derived nostalgic satisfaction from sharing those things with me, things she remembered from her rural childhood in the 1940s, beautiful, obsolete things that almost seemed to delineate the borders of a place where child versions of the two of us might be able to meet. One dark winter afternoon, when one of the kerosene lamps was burning in the living room, I put down my book and wandered into the next room where my mother was blocking together pieces for a quilt. The Phil Donahue show was on the television with the sound turned down low. "Go back and check on that lamp," she'd said after a few minutes. "Okay," I'd replied, but the TV caught my attention and I didn't go. "Is that lamp all right?" she'd asked after another minute. And certain that it was, I told her, "Yes, it's fine." A minute later, something told me to get up and go check. It was a quiet but urgent feeling, and I jumped up to make sure everything was in order. When I got to the living room, I saw a column of flame licking the ceiling. My mother had the presence of mind to cap the top of the lamp with a dish resting on the same table, and luckily the flame consented to being snuffed out, though it left a dark, sooty ring on the ceiling. It took a long time for that spot to fade. Sometimes after Mom had died, I'd be going along as if everything were fine, as if the day were any ordinary day. And the fact of her death, no, not simply the fact of her death, but rather the facts of her death and her life, her presence in this world and the presence her absence made, the whole of what I remembered or lacked, everything she gave and left, and what, in leaving, she took. The fact of all that, like a column of threat and promise and light, would flare bright and hot in my mind. As Black women, our lives matter. Our voices matter, and our experience of cancer can help ensure that there is greater equity of practice and concern in health research. This is a form of social justice, and I'm grateful to be able to help contribute to this mission. Thank you.
That gave me chills. It was so powerful. And thank you, Tracy K. Smith, for sharing your story with us, for sharing your art with us, and for being a light for us today. It was beautiful. So I would like to move us forward to a conversation with the FDA, Food and Drug Administration. And I'd like to introduce to you two people who are going to have this conversation. So we want to speak to, with this next section of our event today, what role the FDA plays in each of our lives, as well as the work that they do to advance clinical care, to advance the treatments, the medical treatments that we all benefit from, and to protect the public as it relates to clinical trials. So I'm honored to introduce Ms. Jacqueline Beal, a survivor, a patient advocate, and a member of the Black Women's Health Imperative Steering Committee for Project TEACH. And I'd also like to introduce Dr. Amy Abernathy, Principal Deputy Commissioner of the Food and Drugs, at the FDA.
Thank you, Dr. Alfie. I appreciate the warm welcome. I am delighted to be joined by Dr. Amy Abernathy. It's a pleasure to have you here, Amy. It's wonderful. We are so honored.
Thank you so much, Jacqueline. It is terrific and an honor to be here with you.
So we want to talk a little bit about, and I think it's extremely timely given everyone is hearing that that acronym FDA lately, as Food and Drug Administration. And as a result of, you know, FDA's role in the approval of the Moderna, Pfizer, and Johnson & Johnson vaccines, I think everyone has some awareness of the FDA. But aside from that, people still may not know what the role of the FDA is in protecting public health, and why should they even care? So can you share with us, you know, what is the FDA and why should people care?
A little bit about the FDA. So the United States Food and Drug Administration is responsible for protecting and promoting public health. And we do that through a variety of ways, but mostly by regulating many of the things that are probably in your own household. So we regulate food and drugs and biological products like vaccines, as well as medical devices such as a implant for a knee or a hip. We also regulate animal and animal foods and animal drugs. We regulate cosmetics. We regulate tobacco. And when we think about it, we regulate almost 20 to 25% of the US and world economy. The other thing to think about is that the US FDA shows up almost every day in your life because we're in your pantry. For example, nutrition labels and information around the regulation of the food that you eat. We are the group that regulates medicines, whether you buy them over the counter or it's a medicine that your doctor writes a prescription for. And we also are directly involved in the oversight process for the design and conduct of clinical trials around medical products in this country, including clinical trials that help to understand the safety and effectiveness of products like the drugs and vaccines and the diagnostic tests that have been used in the context of the pandemic.
You know, wow. I think everyone now is going to pay a little bit more attention to the FDA, especially when we go shop, when we go to our doctor's visits, when we use medications, when we're taking care of our pets. You know, when I even put on mascara now, we'll pay more attention about the role of the FDA. But you did touch on something I want us to stay with for a minute, clinical trials. Now, I know we can both agree that the value of clinical trials is phenomenal. I mean, they make a difference. And I think that's been proven over and over again. However, and I'm sure you're aware of some of this, there's still some hesitancy in participating in clinical trials, especially in the Black community. And understandably so, because, you know, first of mine is likely the Tuskegee experiment or either, you know, Henrietta Lacks. So there's some mistrust and some pause there. And so, you know, talk a little bit about why, you know, the Black community should be comfortable participating in clinical trials now.
Well, I think we've got a lot of work to do to really get to the place of building that trust for the Black community overall, and really for all Americans. Let me back up for a second, though, and just kind of level set on what a clinical trial is, because even the word trial sort of sounds a little funny, right? So these are studies, and the whole idea is to understand whether or not a medical product, such as a drug or a vaccine, is safe and also performs as it's expected to perform. So if this treatment is supposed to prevent you from getting COVID, or if you have COVID, reduce the chance that you need to go into the hospital or reduce the chance of dying from COVID, that's the things that we're looking for within the context of the clinical trial. And clinical trials are very carefully spelled out in an initial written study document that's called a protocol, that's intended to essentially very carefully describe everything that's going to happen so that we can make sure that we keep participants in a clinical trial safe, so we can make sure that the data generated in the clinical trial leads to the answer that is expected, and also so that all of us can look at the output from clinical trials and understand the safety and effectiveness of the product that, for example, sits on the medicine cabinet shelf in our bathroom. And so that's really the purpose of a clinical trial. But let me then back up to one other step, which is that clinical trials involve real people. And in this context of identifying people who are appropriate for the clinical trial, meet the initial set of rules about what it means to study this particular medical product with a group of individuals, that also means that that group of individuals need to learn about the protocol or the clinical trial, need to have the opportunity to know whether or not it's right for them to participate, and also need to be able to ask all the questions. Now, you started off by highlighting that there is really a gap between our, you know, the makeup of our American public and the representation of our Black community and Black women in clinical trials. And that's because I think we've done a poor job across time making sure that we address critical questions like Tuskegee and Henry Adelax, full stop. I think it's also because we've done a poor job in the past, and hopefully starting to fix this, at providing the kind of information and communication to help people know why and how to participate in clinical trials. In November of 2020, we put forward as FDA a guidance, especially in the context of COVID-19, to increase Black and diverse representation within our clinical trials, recognizing how important it is to solve this critical challenge of inclusion for all of us. And things that we said within the context of that guidance is we need to be really thoughtful to make sure that those study protocols, the sort of essentially list of rules to get into the trial, are as inclusive as possible and make it possible for Black women in all communities to be able to be participants. We also said, by the way, we can't just conduct clinical trials in, for example, academic sites or, you know, big cities. We actually have to take clinical trials to where people are, so that as a Black woman, you have the opportunity to have a clinical trial with your doctor, because this is where you get your care, not because you have to travel across the country to get access. So we've done a number of things to try and say, here's what we need to solve for, but we have a lot of work to do together to solve for the trust challenge and also to make sure that this is practical and possible.
That's good to hear, because it sounds like there are some communication efforts to try to distill the myths and encourage participation and address the racism and inequities, and that, you know, those are some of the reasons that the Black community and Black women should feel comfortable in participating. So I applaud the FDA, and I'm glad to hear that. But I will say, Amy, as an 18-year cancer survivor who recognizes the advancements made in diagnosis, treatment, and prevention of cancer, and a lot of that can be contributed to clinical trials, I'm still a little concerned, especially given analysis of data from the FDA indicated that in trials for 24 of, I think it was 31 cancer drugs approved in 2015, less than 5% of the study patients were Black. So that's to your point, we still have a lot of work to do, I think. And one of the questions I have for you is, you know, that since there are very few Black women in clinical trials, given that the Black women comprise 13%, I believe, and, you know, correct my math and statistics here, of the U.S. population, and 11% are female cancer patients. So if the data is informing the basis of FDA's science-based regulatory decision-making, and if Black people are limited in participating in the clinical trials, can you share a little bit more about the decision-making process, especially if research is not inclusive of the Black community?
So as you were giving those statistics, Jacqueline, it just hit me in the heart, right? Like, and I think it hits all of us in the heart here talking about this today. I'm an oncologist. I was a cancer doctor when I was taking care of people at Duke. And you know, there are some diseases in cancer, so triple negative breast cancer, prostate cancer, where, you know, Black people are overrepresented in the illness, and yet our data are underrepresent the people who are most affected. And that's a challenge that we need together as really a research community, FDA community, all of us working together, we need to solve for to make sure that our trials are representative. But let's sort of step back for a second and ask, what else can we do to make sure that within the context of our FDA decision-making, and really also the clinical decision-making at the bedside, we're matching the best that medicine and science has to offer to the person sitting, you know, in your chair or my chair. So really to all of us, and especially for Black women, for today's conversation. And I think it includes a number of things. So first of all, we need to keep working hard on making sure our clinical trials are as inclusive as possible. And I really applaud your work on trying to advance that. It's very important. Secondly, we need to look to other ways to start to fill in the gap of when the information is missing. So importantly, as people start to get access, for example, to a new drug, we should be learning from the story of each person so that your story or my story is basically informing the care of people who are in front of us. And so one Black woman's story informs the care of Black women in the future, whether or not that is for triple negative breast cancer or for a type of colorectal cancer or a disease way outside the cancer setting, such as rheumatoid arthritis. And so by using data that's collected in real world settings, for example, through electronic health records data or information that is an administrative claims data, we can start to fill in that information gap to create a more inclusive picture of how a medical product performs for everyone. Another thing that we need to do is we need to keep pushing as companies are developing their products, as people are thinking about personalization of treatments, about how to understand what products are best for people of all backgrounds, including Black women and other folks of all different, you know, sort of, you know, not both genders, multiple genders, but also all the different ways that we think about people in America. And we need to keep pushing the development and including that in our thinking about developing new studies into the future. And I expect that what you're gonna see is in the decision-making process, we will rely on things like real-world evidence to fill in those gaps and to say, you know, here's what we can understand across time. And then we're also gonna use new clinical trials and new protocol designs in the future to get that smarter. Last thing I'd like to say is that we have an expectation for each medical product that comes on the market to continue to monitor it across time. So that if we see things start to go awry from what we would have expected with respect to safety and effectiveness for people of all backgrounds, then we have the responsibility to try and understand better and now try and figure out, is there something that is about a person's genetic makeup, about their socioeconomic background or something else that tells us how to better match a product to a person's life in the future and to use that continuous evaluation to get that right in the future. So there's a ways that we sort of adopt our decision-making to reflect these different experiences of people.
So it sounds like there are a lot of avenues to participate in these clinical trials. And one thing I always say, we have to be our best champion. And so we're gonna have also advocate on behalf of ourselves to participate in the trials, because I can tell you for years, I was never asked about clinical trials or to participate in them or even made aware of them. And so, you know, again, if Black people are not invited to participate in clinical trials, they'll have that gap. But by the same token, the more we become aware, the more there are things in place to keep aware, that we can be an advocate for ourselves to raise our hands and say, going on with clinical trials, or is there one relative to what's going on with me? And I think we have to do that. And I think Project Teach is a pioneer in trying to lead the way in doing that.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So one last question, and you may have touched on this, but does the FDA have any policy or framework that says, you know what, as part of ensuring there is inclusion relative to these clinical trials and removing the inequities and barriers of making sort of a requirement in these clinical trials, diversity a component of it?
Good question. And, you know, I can't specifically talk about policy that hasn't come out yet or where exactly it's going. But let me say this. You heard me mention a few minutes ago that in November of 2020, we put out, for example, clinical trial guidance that instructed clinical trial developers and medical product developers to incorporate into their trials different features that make it more practical for people of all backgrounds to participate. And the one that I think is just so obvious is that people who are conducting clinical trials need to bring the trials to where patients are, as opposed to being in very specific centers across the country. And so as FDA, we do write guidance that's intended to make trials more inclusive. I also anticipate that important conversations like Project Teach and the conversations that are happening across America right now with respect to, for example, learning about how clinical trials have happened within the context of vaccines and how to be more and more representative in the future are going to help inform not only better clinical trial designs, but also how we think about diversity and making sure that the information that is expected to come to FDA is as inclusive as possible in the future. So that's what I hope is we'll keep the conversation going, because the conversation actually points the way to the future.
We'll definitely keep the conversation going. I know I've learned a lot. I know I know more now than I did before you and I had a chance to chat. Thank you very much for joining us. It's been my pleasure to speak with you.
Jacqueline, it was terrific. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mae McCarmo. I am with the Tiger Lily Foundation, and I'm a steering committee member for Project Teach. I became involved as an advocate for Black women and their health because I am a Black woman, and I learned I had cancer at an early age, and I had to learn how to speak up for myself. Advocacy for me became something that was a way of life. It wasn't natural to me at first, but using my voice really helped me to know how to change outcomes for myself and a woman I loved. And I love doing this work. I love seeing other Black women empowered, being self-advocates, and using their voices to change outcomes for women of color across the nation and the world. It is a fact that the more you know about your body and how to speak up about your health and have a healthy provider relationship, you can have a better dialogue and sometimes, most often, better health outcomes. I think clinical trials are critical to ensuring that we study Black women and the biology of our cancers. The fact is that Black women are least represented in clinical trials, which results in lower outcomes across the cancer care continuum. Being involved means understanding. It means asking the right questions. It means not being afraid, but being fearless in the conquest, in the quest for more informed care and better outcomes for our population. Be fearless in your advocacy, be fearless in your engagement, and be part of a trial.
That video testimonial was just inspiring. I always loved seeing women advocate and speak up for ourselves, particularly sisters, Black women and women of color, because there's so many ways in which we're often silenced or people try to silence us. And so hearing from our last testimonial member of the steering committee for the project and for BWHI is really critical for, in my opinion, just modeling the kind of work that we all want to do in terms of being empowered and advocates for ourselves. So thank you for that as well. Thank you, Ms. Beal. She's just got so much light in her. I just really enjoyed the questions that she asked. And I am very appreciative of her for bringing in the FDA to share some of their perspectives on the work that they're trying to do. So I want to thank all of you, excuse me, for joining us today. It has been a pleasure to share a couple of hours of your afternoon or morning, as the case may be, with you as a part of this project. It really has been just an honor to have the opportunity to speak with all of the guests, to introduce folks, to listen and be educated and to learn, and to share this with you through the virtual space. So in closing, excuse me again, we will have another performance by Clifton Ross III, our musical performer. And as I understand from one of the BET shows, I think it's Sunday Service. I think that's what it is. And it was really enjoyable to be with you today. As I said, having this opportunity to close just allows me to reflect on how important the work of Project Teach is. You all are the reason that we do this work. As I shared, I lost my mother to cancer, pancreatic cancer. You've heard so many people speak today about how cancer has impacted their lives. And we as Black women have a duty and a responsibility to stand up for ourselves, to be empowered, to be those empowered patient partners, whether we're in the throes of it or we have a loved one who is in the throes of dealing with cancer or if we've lost someone. And so our job as a researcher, as a clinician, as a person on the other side of the table is to make sure that we're doing everything we can to make patients feel comfortable coming into the fold. And that's going to take partnership. That's going to take collaboration. And that's going to take people like me closing my mouth sometimes and listening to what our patients have to say to us so that we can do a much better job of making the work that we do inclusive. And that is the mission of Project Teach and the BWHI and partners. So it was a pleasure. Again, I want to thank Ms. Chandra Wilson. We're going to have our musical performance. And we're also going to have closing remarks from Ms. Linda Goler-Blount, the CEO of the Black Women's Health Imperative. I genuinely hope that our conversation today has a lasting positive impact on you. I hope you know that you are seen, are heard, and that you are valued by all of us at Project Teach. I hope that this event has brought awareness and inspired change. I want to thank you. And in closing, I want to echo the words that I just heard earlier. Black women's lives matter. You matter. And thank you so much.
Thank you all again for having me. I'm so honored to be a part of such a dynamic, engaging, and empowering program. Thank you to Project Teach and the powerful organizations that partner to put on this event, including Black Women's Health Imperative, Friends of Cancer Research, and Stand Up to Cancer. Come on and groove with me.
Mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. There's no need to escalate, 'cause war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Picket lines and picket signs, punish me with brutality. Come talk to me so we can see what's going on. What's going on? Hey, what's going on? What's going on? Hey, yeah. Hey, yeah, 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 yeah. Mother, mother, everybody thinks we're wrong, but who are they to judge us simply because our hair is long? You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Come and talk to me so we can see what's going on. Hey, what's going on? Tell me what's going on. Hey, what's going on?
Y'all so much. I've had such a wonderful time.
Well, thank you, Clifton. We can all feel it. Thank you for that. Thank you for the motivation, the inspiration. This is the time for change. This has been a truly powerful and engaging program for uplifting the importance of including Black women in cancer research. Thank you for your comments and questions. I know we couldn't get to them all, but we will answer as many as we can, and we will post them after today's program. So don't think that we didn't hear you. We did, and we will get you answers. On behalf of Project Teach, thank you for being a part of today's program. This has been wonderful. I want to thank Dr. Elfie, our project partners, Stand Up to Cancer, Friends of Cancer Research, as well as the powerful speakers and artists that we were privileged to have for today's program. I hope that we can all agree today, especially after all that we've heard, that inequities in cancer research are unnecessary and avoidable and must become a priority for medical progress and frankly, for public health. As Dr. Owens knows, there's no such thing as the hard to reach. There's only the hardly reached. And thank you to Ms. Nina Pryor for sharing your experiences, your courage, and helping women to know how important advocacy is and that our physicians must come correct. It's about how you say it. And I like what Dr. Pierce and Dr. May said. Dr. Pierce talked about patients being the captains of their ships and that they have to be comfortable with their physicians. So I would sort of paraphrase this. You won't take bad service from your cable repair person. Don't take it from your physicians. We deserve the best care we can get. And Dr. Abernathy and Ms. Beal talked about the need for real world evidence to ensure therapeutics are effective for Black women. Yes, we need to participate in clinical research. We need to inform the science so therapeutics and drugs work well for us as they are supposed to. But we also need this real world evidence. Dr. Elfie talked about the lived experiences of Black women. We need to understand what happens after we stop taking the therapeutics or after we get to our lives. What happens as we are navigating the challenges, the barriers, the systemic racism that we face every day. All of these things are connected and they do inform how well our bodies respond to drugs and therapeutics, and they should inform the research. We need to bring trials to where people are. And I think that's something that Ms. Beal talked about. We need to make it easy to participate in clinical research. There are organizations called contract resource organizations that help design clinical trials and protocols and develop recruitment strategies. Well, they tend to recruit from their network, that what they know. We need to help these organizations understand the importance of diversity and how to attract patients in a respectful manner outside of their traditional networks. So I hope you have enjoyed today's program. Please go to teachforblackwomen.org to get the toolkit, to receive more information about the project, and to make sure you have access to the complete suite of tools for Black women. Project Teach is committed to making a difference. It is just a pilot, however. It will take significant resources to ensure that all Black women have the information and the tools they need to be advocates for themselves, and their families in clinical research and to receive the care that they deserve. Please go to bwhi.org to support the work of the Black Women's Health Imperative and teach to ensure that Black women are included in clinical research and do have the information they need to advocate for themselves, to make sure that they get the best possible outcomes from cancer and other diseases, and that they are included in science so that we can no longer talk about applying a body of evidence to people who had nothing to do with its creation in the first place. Thank you for listening, and please be well.
Wow, what an event. I hope you were entertained, but educated and informed. I hope you're leaving feeling supported, inspired, and empowered. Thank you for joining us today. To learn more about Project Teach, please visit teachforblackwomen.org.